Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulillah wa ba'd. Having spoken about schooling and so on and so forth, we talked about what is wrong with schooling currently and what needs to be done. I want to now come to the detailed mechanics of what needs to be done, and we want to begin with the Quranic methodology of teaching as prescribed in the Quran. One of the important things to understand is that in Islam there is no contradiction, there is no gap between theology and science, between teaching of religion and teaching of secular or so-called secular subjects. I don't like the term secular subject because it assumes that the subject has no relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But obviously any knowledge of any kind comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu. So technically speaking, even though a part of knowledge may not be theology as such, meaning religious sciences, but every knowledge, no matter what that knowledge is divinely inspired. It has a divine connection, and that is how human beings know what it is, whether it's physics or chemistry or biology or anything you like, or astronomy or whatnot. So therefore, but just for us to understand, I'm using this term secular knowledge or secular teaching, but I want to clarify that I don't mean it in that way. So now, when we look at the Quranic teaching methodology, let us see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu said about teaching itself very specifically. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before he mentioned the methodology of teaching, he praised people of intelligence and he mentioned them and he said what it is that distinguishes them. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the ayat of Surah Al-Imran, Allah said, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن في خلق السماوات والأرض واختلاف الليل والنهار لآيات لأولي الألباب الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سُبْحَانَكَ فَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned people of intelligence and he praised them and he said that in the creation of the heavens and the earth and the alternation of the day and the night, there are signs for al-ulil al-bab, people of intelligence. There is a lecture of mine on al-ulil al-bab, so you can listen to that separately. But here Allah then described who are these people. Alladhina yadhkuruna Allaha qiyaman wa qu'udan wa 'ala junubihim. Al-ulil al-bab, people of intelligence and people of knowledge and people of understanding, are people who recognize their Rabb, who recognize their Creator, and who remember Him standing, sitting and lying down. The three stages of a human being's existence. So which means that who are people of intelligence? Those who recognize their Creator and then who remember their Creator in every aspect of their life. Who remember the Creator in their private space, who remember the Creator in their public space, who remember their Creator when they are with themselves, who remember their Creator when they are with other people, who remember their Creator when they are reflecting, who remember their Creator when they are interacting, who remember their Creator when they are dealing with people, who remember their Creator when they are standing before Him Jalla Jalaluhu on their own, who remember their Creator when they are speaking to a million people on a global platform, who remember their Creator meaning what? Meaning that they are obedient to the Creator, because remembering the Creator and disobeying Him in simultaneously is oxymoronic. It does not make any sense. So remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means to accept and understand and recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then to be obedient to Him Jalla Jalaluhu. So this is the issue of al-ulil al-bab. These are the people. And then what did Allah say? He described them. He said, these are the people who do this. And wa yatafakkaruna fi khalqi samawati wal ard. He said, they do this and they do research. They do fikr. They do reflection. They do thinking. They do conceptualizing. They put themselves deeply into the creation of the heavens and the earth. Everything that comes under the umbrella of science and technology and discovery and research is covered by this. All that we are doing currently and all that we will do in the future, bismillahi ta'ala, which we do not do currently because we don't know. But as Allah opens the doors for those ulum, when they come into the realm of science and technology, all of them are covered by this phrase in the Quran, yatafakkaruna fi khalqi samawati wal ard. Everything is fikr fi khalqi samawati wal ard. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described two related qualities of people of intelligence. First quality, Allah described the two qualities and He described the relationship and priority of these two qualities. First quality, they recognize their Rabb Jalla Jalaluhu and they are obedient to Him. And second quality is, and Allah did not say wa yatafakkarun. Allah did not say aw yatafakkarun. Allah said wa yatafakkarun. If you take the sentence itself, الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُودًا وَعَلَىٰ جُنُوبِهِمْ أَوْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. If you write this as a sentence in Arabic, grammatically it is correct. But the meaning is completely different. The meaning of that is, there are two kinds of intelligent people. Those who remember Allah and those who are scientists and technologists. Those who research in the creation. But that's not what the ayat is saying. The ayat is saying there is only one kind of intelligent person. Not two kinds of intelligent people. Only one kind of intelligent person. Who is that? Who remembers Allah and who does this. So there is no dichotomy or there is no gap or gulf between theology and science in Islam. Theology is part of science and science is part of theology. And that's why we say integrated teaching and education. It is integrated. We are the ones who broke it apart. Allama Sayyid Sulaiman Nadwi Rahmatullah Alayhi, one of the greatest scholars of this of the subcontinent, he said this over 100 years ago. In a public, that lecture is published. He said this over 100 years ago. He said that the greatest crime that was committed, this is the sabse badi ghalti jo humne ki, the biggest mistake we made was to separate Allah from the creation, is to separate religious knowledge from scientific knowledge. He said people imagined that religious knowledge meant to go and sit in one place and make zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and scientific knowledge meant to run a shop or do research or be a scientist and so on. He said this is the biggest mistake we made, to separate religious knowledge from so-called secular knowledge. He said that is not the concept of Islam. The concept of Islam is to live in this world. To live in this world according to the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the ibadah. To run a business in a halal way according to Islamic principles is ibadah. The businessman is actually engaged in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while he's buying and selling. And the same thing applies across the board. You name the profession, as long as the person who is doing that profession is a Muslim, recognizes Allah and lives his life according to the orders of Allah and does that business or does that activity, whatever it is, according to the principles of Islam and the Sunnah of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that person, he or she is engaged in ibadah. That person is engaged in worship, and that is how the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where He said, "Wa ma khalaqtul jinna wal insa illa liya'budun." I have not created the jinn or the insan for anything other than my worship. This is how that becomes possible. Allah does not give an order that cannot be obeyed. Allah does not make a statement that is not true. So when Allah said, I have not created human beings and jinn for anything other than my worship, then it means that to live this life 100%, every single action of my life must become ibadah, must become worship. Otherwise, the Quran statement cannot be true. We know the statement of the Quran is true. How do you make it worship? By this. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us. يذكرون الله قياما وقودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض. And Allah then told us, what is the automatic result of teaching and learning in this sequence? What is the result? ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سبحانك Subhanaka faqina adhaban nar. The person remembers the meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and says, oh Allah, you did not create all this in vain. All of this is not a joke, it's not play, it's not a game. All of this has been done for a purpose, and oh Allah, save me from the hellfire. This is the beauty of the Quran. So if somebody ever asks you a question and say, Islam, in Islam, what about science and theology? Read them, recite for them this ayah. إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتٍ لِّأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا سُبْحَانَكَ فَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. This is the meaning of teaching and learning in Islam. So let's take this and say, therefore, what should be the first priority in schools? This applies equally to parenting, believe me. But since we are on schools, we talk about that. First priority, therefore, is recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because that's the first criterion of learning. So recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jalla Jalal. Connect to Allah. Teach students how to connect to Allah. Tell me, how will you teach students how to connect to Allah? How can you teach students, your children or your students, how can you teach them how to connect to Allah? How? You should know. You should be connected. How else? Is there another way? Is there some other way? I am not connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't know, I have no clue who is Allah. I have no connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I want you to connect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is it possible? The only way I can help you to connect to Allah is if I am connected. If I am not connected, I cannot connect you. The charger will convey the current into your phone battery only if the charger is plugged into the source of power. Simply take the charger, stick it into the phone, nothing will happen. The charger does not create the power. Power is somewhere else. Connect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, number one. Number two, introduce them to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? Because that is how he can make every action of his into an ibadah. By what? By how? By following the sunnah of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How can I make my action, how can I make my drinking water into ibadah? By drinking water the way Muhammad Rasulullah drank water. And across the board. I mean, I can give you a million examples, I don't need to give them. You can give them to yourself. Every single action of ours becomes an action of ibadah if it is done according to the sunnah of Muhammad Rasulullah. So the person must know who is Muhammad. And when I say no, it means there must be a connection with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There must be the love of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his heart. Number three, make the akhirah real for them. How can the akhirah become real for them? When it is real for me. Do I really seriously believe that I will be resurrected after I die? This is a question we have to ask ourselves. Do I really believe this? I know I will say that. But do I really seriously believe that once I am dead, I will be resurrected and I will stand before Allah? If I seriously believe that, then that has to be reflected in my life. There is no other way. If my life does not reflect my belief in the Akhirah, then I do not have that belief in the Akhirah. Number four, enable them to love the Quran. And I'm going to ask these guys to send you also, I have a series of 6 or 7 lectures on how to teach Quran. So please see them as well. Enable them to love the Quran. Believe me, the way we teach the Quran is a crime. We teach the Quran purely by rote. We teach the Quran purely by character recognition, which is just Nazara. They recognize a letter and they learn how to make the sound that corresponds to that letter. We teach them nothing else. We do not even teach them the meaning of the Quran. And may Allah forgive me, there are people who have, and so-called scholars who have argued with me, and you know, I mean, I don't fight with anybody, but they decided to fight, and one of them walked off and doesn't say salam to me. I said, no problem, khalas, what do I do? Because I said, teach the meaning of the Quran. This is my crime, and on the day of judgment, I will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the crime. Yeah? I said, teach the meaning of the Quran. जिसे नहीं पढ़ा सकते बच्चे नहीं पढ़ते पढ़े तो समझ में नहीं आता हिफ्ज नहीं हो सकता साहबा कैसे हिफ्ज करे दे कैनॉट बिकम हिफाज दे कैनॉट मेमोराइज द कुरान इफ दे नो द मीनिंग कंप्लीटली इनसेन आर्ग्यूमेंट आई सेड हाउ डिड द साहबा बिकम हिफाज बट द साहबा हिफाज यू मीन दे वर रिसाइटिंग जस्ट लाइक दैट जस्ट द साउंड दे हैव नो क्लू व्हाट दे आर सेइंग अंडरस्टैंड दिस थिंग वेरी क्लियरली वी डू नॉट डू दिस विद एनी अदर बुक on the planet. You read a comic book, Donald Duck, you understand the meaning of what's in that book. But the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have no clue what we are saying. We just make sounds. Is it called reading? Would you call it reading? We have to change that. We have to teach the Quran in a way that inspires the child. We have to teach the Quran in a way which brings tears to the eyes. We have to teach Quran in the way which excites him, which it completely changes his internal physiology. If you attach monitors to him, his blood pressure must go up, his mental activity must go up. Inspiration has to come. How will that come if it is not even in me? And the last one is, reveal to them the secret about the Sunnah. What is the secret about the Sunnah? I just told you. What is it? It makes every action into ibadah. The secret of the Sunnah is, it makes every action into an action of worship. This is the great secret of the Sunnah. Every action becomes an action of worship. That action you would have taken anyway. Because it's your need. I have to eat lunch, so I will eat some food. I have to drink water, I'm thirsty, and so on and so on. How can I change an action which I would do for myself into an action of worship, which means Allah will reward me for it? How? By doing it according to the Sunnah of Muhammad Rasulullah. That is the secret of Sunnah. So the first priority is teach the children all of these things. And as I said, the only way to do that is if I do it first. There's no way a teacher is going to teach that. There's no way a parent is going to teach that if they are disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala themselves. No matter how small you think the disobedience is, thinking a disobedience to be small is the biggest disobedience. So, think about that. To achieve all of this, what do we need to do? Tazkiyatun nafs, purification of the heart. Separating and clearing the heart from all negative emotions. Teach them to deal with anger, frustration, depression, hatred, arrogance, and many more things. Greed. Showing off. All of these are diseases of the heart. Fear. All of these are cardiac problems. These are things which affect the qalb. The heart has to be purified and removed. All of this must be cleaned. Then the heart reflects the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tarbiyatul akhlaq. Whatever the knowledge of the scholar must be visible in the actions of the scholar. You can claim to have any knowledge in the world. You can be hafiz of the Quran, and you can be hafiz of Seerah, and you can memorize, you can do whatever you want. If that knowledge is not visible in your actions, then you do not have that knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave a name for people like that. Kama salil himar yahmilu asfara. Allah said they are donkeys carrying books. They're carrying the load, but doesn't do them any good. It's not worth. The donkey does not benefit from the book. He just has the load. He's carrying the weight. Third one, demonstrate by personal example. Rasulullah did not teach akhlaq by talking about akhlaq. He taught akhlaq by behaving that way. People came to Islam because they fell in love with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not because he convinced them by great arguments. No. And the last one is study of Seerah and biographies of the Sahaba and biographies of anybody, not only Muslim. Not only Muslim. There's some wonderful lessons to be learned from the biographies of people who are not Muslim but who did great things. So teach that. And as I said, the teacher must stand in the night and cry before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask for the help of Allah. I always say to teachers when I speak to them, I say, if the inspiration is not in your heart, go do something else. Go do something else. Don't do violence to yourself and to the children by being a teacher. You are not fit to be a teacher. It is not a condemnation of you. Not everyone is fit for everything. No problem. Maybe you are fit to be something else. Go be that something else. Do not be a teacher. I'm not condemning you when I say you're not fit to be a teacher. No. It's just that you are not capable of that. Supposing you say, I want to run the marathon in the New York marathon. I say, well, physically you're not fit. So don't do that. Now I'm not condemning you. I'm just saying that this is not for you. So if you are not inspired from inside to be a teacher, please, please, please do me a favor, do yourself a favor, stop teaching. Go get yourself another job. And what is the sign that you are inspired? That message in the red box. If you are not standing in the night and crying before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are not inspired. Then what must we do? Shape attitudes, because everything begins with attitude. What are the five attitudes that must be inculcated? Number one is contribution, not consumption. Today we have a big, huge problem with an entitlement attitude that people have. Everyone thinks they are entitled to something. I am entitled to a government which is just and fair. You are not entitled to anything. You want a government which is just and fair? You have to work for it. You have to work for it. I am entitled to children who will look after me in my old age. No. Sorry, you're not entitled to that. You have to work for it. Nobody is entitled to anything. We have to work for it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the rule. I'm not making the rule. وَاللَّيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى قَالَ تَعَالَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, for the human being, there is nothing except that which he works for. No entitlement. So teach them that. Contribution, not consumption. Humility, not arrogance. This whole thing today of the love for publicity. Everything must go onto Facebook, everything must go on this and tweet that. Completely destroys all internal intention, ikhlas, everything has gone down the drain. Because you are worried about how many hits on Facebook did I get? How many likes on Facebook? Seriously, we have to ask this question. Humility. The greater the scholar, the more humble he becomes or she becomes. See our Salaf, what they did. We have the example of Rasulullah himself. We have the example of the Sahaba. We have the example of Salafus Salihin. Humility across the board. Confidence, not dependence. The ability to stand and speak your part. The ability to take a stance on the basis of principles. Not afraid of anybody. How will that happen? If you bring this about in schools. If you encourage that. When the student stands up and demands his right or her right, and you are the one denying them that right, then you have to stop and ask yourself this question and say, the student is right. I am wrong. That's how confidence develops. Number four, collaboration, not competition. Destructive internal competition. This destroys families, destroys people. We need to collaborate. We need to share our knowledge. We need to share our resources freely without asking for any return. And number five, compassion, not selfishness. Today, in terms of the world, there is enough wealth in this world to ensure that every single human being that lives on the face of this earth gets 3 full meals, gets access to good schools, gets access to good and proper health care, gets access to clean drinking water, gets access to housing, basic needs. There is enough wealth to ensure that every single human being on the face of this earth can get access to all of this without any problem. Then why do we have poverty? Is it a resources issue or is it a compassion issue? Why do we have poverty? Ask yourself, you build a big mansion for yourself. You know, many of our friends, alhamdulillah, wealthy people, you build a big mansion for yourself. Then you build servant quarters. Ask your question, will you live in that servant quarter? Even for one night. If you will not live in that servant quarter even for one night, if you go into that toilet in the servant quarter, you cannot pass because your upper class crap will not come out in that toilet. How do you expect that person to live in that place? So, resources or compassion? And if you say that you are doing all of this, what are the metrics? What you do not measure, you do not control. Simple as that. If you say that in my school I am teaching people contribution, not consumption, what are the metrics to say that you are doing this? If you say I am teaching my students to have humility and not arrogance, what are the metrics? What is the measurement? What is the standard? What is the criterion which shows that this is actually happening? What you cannot measure, you cannot control. There must be metrics for each one of these things. And if you think that how can I have metrics for this, let me give you an example from the business world. The Lexus, most successful luxury car in the American market, and of course globally, Toyota's luxury car, Lexus. The development of the Lexus is a very interesting story. The engineers who were developing Lexus, they went to the owners of luxury cars. They went to people who owned Bentleys and Rolls Royces and the upper series, 7 and so on, series of BMWs and Mercedes and so on. And they asked them questions like, for example, they said, when you sit in the back of a Rolls Royce, what do you feel? How do you feel when you sit in the back of a Rolls? How do you feel when you floor the accelerator of a 7 series BM? Yeah, it does a thing like this. And then you go, boom. What do you feel when somebody shuts the door of a Bentley and you get this very satisfying deep thunk? It doesn't go clang like a tin can. Say, what do you feel? Who's asking this question? Engineers. And then they took these, within quotes, feeling, touchy-feely statements, and they converted them into the most concrete thing in the world, which is an engineering drawing. Into actual measurements. And that's how the Lexus was born. Outsold every other car. So if you tell me that you can't have metrics for compassion and so on, no, of course you can have metrics. Of course, if you can have metrics for how does it feel to sit in the back of a Rolls, you can have metrics to show whether you have compassion or not. But unless you have metrics, this will not be achieved. All of this will be some holy motherhood statement that you think you are having. No. You have to have metrics. Number it. Then teach life skills. Please notice I haven't even come to physics, chemistry, maths and so on. All of this is far more important. And all of this is linked, integrated with the rest of it. Teach them first, very important, teach them how money works. Most of our children know how money works. Take it from daddy, spend it. If daddy does not give, ask mom to get dad. Dad is the ATM machine, mom is the card. That's not how money works. Teach them how money works. Teach them how to take money and roll it. Teach them entrepreneurship. You give them a pocket money, ask them, make a budget. End of the month, give me an expense statement. How did you spend your pocket money? How did you make this money earn for you? You must get to a situation where the son comes to you and says, Dad, here is a BMW key for you. I bought the car for you. How? Out of my pocket money, which you have been giving me for so many years. How did the car come? No, I'm doing a business. I turned it around. Thank you so much for the pocket money for all these years. Here's the car for you. That is what you should have. That's the meaning of entrepreneurship and teaching them how money works. Teach them investment. Not only in material stuff. Look at his expense statement and say, where is charity in this? Did you give any sadaqah? Did you give any money to the poor? That's investment in the akhirah. وَمَا تُقَدِّمُوا لِأَنفُسِكُمْ مِنْ خَيْرٍ تَجِدُهُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ هُوَ خَيْرًا وَعَازَمَ أَجْرَهُ. Where is that investment in your akhirah? What did you do? Teach them politics. Very important. Children must know how your system works. Children must know how the constitution works. Children must know how the parliament works. Children must know how elections are run, what happens, what is happening, what should happen. Politics is the art of influencing. Politics is not a bad word. Politics is a very good word. It's the art of influencing. Teach them that. Teach them conflict resolution. Adabul ikhtilaf. Today, what is destroying this ummah is lack of adabul ikhtilaf. One little disagreement and we are finished. It's a cancer. It's a horrible cancer with this ummah. We do not know how to deal with people who disagree with us. I teach a course in the FSI, in the Foreign Service Institute in Washington, D.C. for American Foreign Service officers and officers of different agencies in the U.S. And usually when I teach that course, I send a presentation of what I am going to say to the director of that course for him to have a look at it. I sent him a presentation recently and I get an email from him saying that he says, your presentation is extremely challenging and it makes me very uncomfortable. But my discomfort is less important than listening to you saying these things to us. We need to have these things said to us and we need to listen to that. So I fully support your presentation. Can you believe this? This is one thing I have seen. By and large, I am making a general statement. So obviously, like all generalizations, it does not apply to every human being. But by and large, my experience of the West, and I have worked and lived there and I still live and work there, is Westerners are much more open to being challenged, to dissent and to have people disagree with them than our people. Our people, one thing you say which they don't like, you are trash. Until that time, oh mashallah, sheikh this, sheikh that. After that, to me it doesn't matter because inshallah al-musta'an, I do whatever I do for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I was not interested in your praise, I'm not interested in your unjustified criticism. But the point is, what does it say about your own attitude? You cannot take a single critical statement about yourself and your and statements are based on fact. I'm giving you an actual fact. You know it's a fact. Why did you have to say that? So as if by not saying it changes it. How does it change it? Very, very important. Conflict resolution. Negotiation skills. As they say, you do not get what you deserve. You get what you negotiate. Media analysis. Extremely important. Most of us are media consumers. Nothing more. We sit there and whatever junk comes to us, we internalize it. You have to teach children how to deal with media, how to analyze what comes, how to take, what to take, what not to take. And then a step beyond that, how to create media. Thought steering. How do you present what you need to present in a way which influences people? Communication. spoken communication, written communication, one-on-one communication, public communication. Four different things. Discipline of the dialogue as different from discussion. Each of these is a subject by itself, so I'm not going into the details of that, but two different things. Discussion is something else, dialogue is something else. Discussion is, here is an issue, break it into pieces, try to understand it. Dialogue is, here is a problem with five different people with five different points of view. What happens? What normally happens with us? Boom. What can happen with dialogue? Five people come together to solve the problem. It is not me versus you, it is me plus you, plus you, plus you, plus you versus the problem. The difference of opinion becomes a strength. You have to learn this. All of these are learnable, all of these are teachable. And as I said here, photography and filmmaking, very important, records history. And above all, teach them discipline. Must come from inside. What is discipline? Discipline is to do what needs to be done, not only what you like to do. Discipline is to live by your word. You promise to do something, you must do it. No one needs to remind you. If you promise to do something and you don't do it, then you really can't even look in the mirror. You should not be able to look at your own face in the mirror. That is the meaning of discipline. Ask people who have gone to boarding schools. I went to a boarding school. Ask somebody who has been in the military in some way or the other. When you get up in the morning, what's the first thing you do? You make your bed. Inside, it comes from inside. You make your bed. You do not leave your bed with the sheets and so on crumpled, even though you know somebody will come and make it. I do it in hotels. My wife does it in the hotel. Sometimes I tell her, why is there housekeeping? She says, I don't care. I don't want anyone else to come into the room and find this whole bed in a mess. Internal sense of discipline. Teach life skills. Art, drama, literature, poetry. Today we are bankrupt. You talk to I'm not bashing young people, but I'm saying by and large, no knowledge of anything. They've not read the classics in any language. They've not read the classics. They've not read any poetry. They don't understand poetry. If you tell them a Sher, the beauty of poetry is a huge thought is encapsulated in two lines, in one line. What's the good of that? You tell the line, he doesn't understand. Gone away. So what is the meaning? Can you please translate? The best way to destroy poetry is to translate it. Artisan crafts, making things with your hand. This is a very therapeutic thing and it's a very powerful thing. So things like carpentry, pottery and so on, where you make things with your hand, by yourself, you use your hands. Teach them to appreciate difference. Difference in culture, difference in religion, difference in beliefs. All kinds of differences. Please understand, I'm not using the word tolerate. According to me, tolerance and being tolerant is not the required thing. We need to appreciate. You don't tolerate dark chocolate. You love it, you appreciate it. Tolerating implies dislike. I tolerate something which I ideally dislike. Ideally, I wish that wasn't there. But since it is there, I tolerate it. I am saying as human beings, we have to get out of this. We have to appreciate the fact that somebody is different. As a Muslim, I need to appreciate the fact that this friend of mine is not a Muslim. As a Hindu, I need to appreciate the fact that this friend of mine worships only one God. Very important. And comes from childhood. Has to be taught. Teach gardening, teach agriculture, ecology, conservation, survival skills, orienteering. Take the child, put him in the middle of somewhere, he can find his way out because he knows how to map himself looking at the stars. Teach them woodcraft. You go into a forest, what do? Archery, shooting, fishing, horsemanship, not horse riding. Big difference between horsemanship and horse riding. Horsemanship is the entire gamut of not just riding the horse, taking care of the animal. That is what teaches responsibility. That's how you, keeping pets is a wonderful thing. Learning to train animals is a wonderful thing. And then of course the rest of it, swimming, so on. And love for service. I have lived in Gond village huts. I have slept in slums. Alhamdulillah. You cannot understand until you go there. That's what you must make them do. Take them there, put them there, let them understand. Teach them that value is intrinsic. Value is not what comes from people's praise. Value is what you actually have. The Jacob diamond has a value. Whether anyone praises it or not, it has a value. There's an intrinsic value in something. And that's what gives you confidence. It doesn't matter, somebody praises or doesn't praise. Imam Shafi Rahmatullah said, if you do not want to be hurt by unjustified criticism, do not feel happy with unjustified praise. Teach through projects. And this is where you will understand what I meant by small class size, multiple ages, multiple teachers. Now why projects? Because projects is a wonderful way of almost, I don't like to use the word enforcing, but encouraging to the point of enforcement, the participation of children themselves in the learning. In a teaching by projects, learning is no longer a one-way thing. It's a two-way thing. The teacher is also learning, the student is also learning. It's a dynamic relationship. So how do you do that? You choose a topic. I'll give you an example in a second. You choose a topic and then you teach all subjects together with that topic. For example, project is oceans. So here's the topic, oceans. Now in this topic of oceans, you are teaching biology. You are teaching chemistry, composition of water. You are teaching physics, displacement, Archimedes principle, displacement with float ships. You are teaching geography, navigation, all the great navigators, all the great sailors, orienteering, orientation, sailing, Qibla, how do you find it? What are the fiqh usul related to water? What about ghusl and wudu with salt water? What about burial at sea? History, maritime history of nations. What is it that took a damp little island on the top of Europe and made it into a global power? Sailing. Nothing else. Sailing. They were the people. How is it that Arab dhows, and the Arabs were sailing long before the British were anywhere near a ship. How is it that the Arabs did not reach the same way? Because they could not invent a ship which could cross a major ocean. So all of their sailing, most of their sailing was coastal. They did not have ships which could stay at sea for months and years together. Takes the ship 3 years to cross the ocean. No problem. The ship is still able to sustain and able to cross. They discovered the cure for scurvy because of ships. Lack of vitamin C produces disabilities. And somebody discovered that eating oranges helps. How did that whole thing happen? Because sailors were at sea. There was no access to vitamin C. They were eating maybe fish or whatever. They used to eat those, what is called sea biscuits, which was like iron. And they got into problem with scurvy. So their joints were, you know, and they couldn't work and so on. So until somebody discovered oranges and said, oh my God, fantastic. It's cured to scurvy. We're still on the same subject, oceans. Trade routes. How did the Panama Canal get built? Why? Why is the Cape of Good Hope called the Cape of Good Hope? Why is Cape Horn called Cape Horn? Not only the shape of it, the tip of South America. What happens in Cape Horn? Because that's the closest place to Antarctica. What happens with the ocean currents and so on and so forth? issues of Tahara, issues of Tafsir of the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the ayat of the oceans. Where are those oceans? Where are those ayat? Looking at fiqh, masail of fiqh related to that, ahadith of the ocean, ahadith of fish and so on. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Seerah, stories of mariners, stories of Sahaba and so forth, and other people. All of this on the same, on one topic. You've taught them all the subjects and more on one topic, which is called oceans. That is the meaning of project. Now what happens here also is you're not just standing there giving lectures. No, no lectures. Students are given the opportunity to discover all of this on their own. And as I told you, today we have this fantastic situation where all of this knowledge and more is available free of cost on the internet. We have books of every kind. So in the project teaching, students are formed into groups, multiple age groups. Teachers, subject teachers are there, so there's a biology teacher and there's a physics teacher and so on and so forth. Not all the teachers are there at the same time, but on different days. A class teacher is there to keep track of the students, because that class teacher stays with the students throughout the school, throughout their school life. And they discover. They go, they do research, they come back, they produce things, they present. Then the teacher will add value to that presentation. And you enrich that presentation with experience. Go sailing, take them sailing, take them to a seashore, camp on the seashore, listen to the sound of the waves as you are lying in your tent. What does it do for you inside? Catch fish, cook fish, eat fish. Right? That is the meaning. Now imagine you teach like this, you won't have students who fall asleep in the class? That is the meaning of project. That's the meaning of integrated teaching. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about Maraj al-Bahrain. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, هو الذي مرج البحرين هذا عذب فرات وهذا ملء أجاج وبينهما برزق وحجرا محجورا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, He is the one who let loose these two salt and fresh water seas together, and there is a wall between them which cannot be crossed. Where is this? Allah is not talking about Jannah. He's talking about this world. Who must ask this question? Who must answer this question? Take another project, say mountains. Talk about geology. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about mountains aspect. Wal jibala awtada. That's a geology statement. Mountains are pegs which anchor the tectonic plates, which stabilizes the earth, and so there are no earthquakes. This is Quran. This is Tafsir. Integrating of knowledge. Which mountains? What is the root of a mountain? How do you measure the height of a mountain? You don't walk around there. You don't climb the mountain with a string and then measure the string. How do you do that? What is the meaning of triangulation? It's not another word for strangulation. How do you measure the weight of a mountain? Can be done, you know. How do you measure the volume of an ocean? Project teaching. You're teaching math. You're teaching geometry. Geography and history. How did mountains... What do mountains do with regard to rain, for example? What is a windward side and a leeward side of a mountain? Why is there rain on one side of the mountain more than the other side? How are mountain deserts? Why is Ladakh a desert? Well, at this side of the mountain, you have phenomenal rain. Chirapunji is on one side of the mountain. On the other side of the mountain is Ladakh. You're teaching geography. You're teaching precipitation. You're teaching monsoons. Biology, mountain flora, fauna, and so on and so forth. History, how did mountains affect the area? This country is a classic case of how mountains affected the history of this entire nation for centuries. Tafsir, Seerah, mountain of Ahad, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, this mountain is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this mountain of Jannah. He said, I love Ahad. I was in Medina recently, and Dr. Azhar told me this beautiful statement which Bhabi told him. And he said that, she said, I believe she told him that, may Allah bless you for this, and we thought of this myself. He said that, she said to him, that this is the thing that when you are looking at it, you know that this Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam also saw, exactly as it is.
That same mountain.
Same mountain in the same way. Even Masjid al-Nabawi today, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not see Masjid al-Nabawi the way it is today. But Uhud is the only thing. So when you're standing and looking at Uhud, you say, Wallah. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam saw it like this. I am seeing it like this. Man, Allah put these things in the hearts of people. May Allah bless you and keep the heart like that, where it receives these thoughts from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu. So ahadith, and then go camping in mountains. I was teaching a course in the police academy in Gwaldam in Uttarakhand, and then after the course finished, I went with battalion, with a group of them, not battalion, but some of the officers. We went up to a place called Devariya Tal, which is 20,000 feet up, and we camped in the night. The view, fantastic lake in the middle, and it's a little mountain top. And we camped in that, and when you wake up in the morning, it's a beautiful clear morning. And when you wake up in the morning, we see the reflection of the Trishul, the three peaks of snow peaks of Himalayas. You see the reflection of that in that lake. What a sight, subhanAllah. And the lake is completely ringed with rhododendron bushes, which were in flower. So it was like completely covered in red flowers totally, and reflection of the
mountain.
Of the mountain. A totally different view of what is a mountain, what is... That is the issue. That is what teaching means. Rappelling. I stood on the tip of Sinagar Fort, which is in Pune. Strapped into the harness with a rope and jump off. You look down there, 500 feet straight down to rocks. That's how you learn rappelling. So you conquer your fear. Once you go down, now you are having great fun because you know how to control the ropes and therefore you don't fall. This is the meaning. Climb Kilimanjaro. Climb Mount Rainier. Climb Fujiyama. All of these are treks, you can do that. Go to your school, they ask your kids, where is Fujiyama? This is our education. Absolutely tragic. Ask them where is Kilimanjaro. Ask them where is Mount Rainier. We're coming to the end of our presentation. Therefore, very important for us to teach them to think and question, not just take in facts. Teach them to question. Teach them to ask questions. Teach them to say, ask why not? Why something? Why not? Why can't I walk on water? Is that a legitimate question or no? Yes. Very legitimate. Why not? What is the physics behind it? Why can't I walk on water? So what if this happens? The earth is angled at a particular angle. So what if that angle is changed by 2 degrees? Dissension. Disagreement. Intelligent disagreement. How do you do that? Close the loop. Person says, I don't like this, no problem. So how would you like it? That's the way to deal with it. Not to say, shut up. Who are you to say I don't like? No. Study the Seerah. Part of curriculum, part of syllabus. Study the Seerah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Allah said, the best example for you is the life of my Nabi. How come we don't study it? Who did Allah tell this to? Study the Seerah, study biographies, not only of Sahaba, of Muslims or non-Muslims. Show how the ethics, values, morals, principles, systems of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam are applicable even today. I wrote this book called Leadership Lessons from the Life of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. For the same reason. Same things from the 7th century are applicable today because the world is still the same. We have still the same forces that are happening, and if we follow what the Prophet ﷺ did, we can become highly successful in today's world. Make Nabi ﷺ real to them. Bring theology alive. This may not apply to all schools, but definitely Muslim schools. Bring theology, bring it alive. Show them why. When they are teaching history, tell them, ask them the question, this is what happened. What would you have done in this situation? Today we teach history in a very, very, very bad way, without any integrity. We cherry pick bits and pieces from history. One little piece from here, one little piece from there. In the middle, we leave it alone. Why? Lessons of history come sometimes from very unpleasant things which happen. Like we learn from pain. Unless we are willing to talk about those things, unless we are willing to extract lessons from them, we'll never learn anything. So read history. Do not read only Muslim writers. Read writers who are not Muslim, who are critical. Because that's how your eyes and ears open. Nothing wrong with that. We must read. We must read. We have to differentiate between criticizing and critical analysis. This is a big problem with us. We think critical analysis is criticizing. We are not criticizing anybody. We are looking at critical analysis. In this situation, what were the options available to so and so and so and so? What did they do? What would have happened if they had done something else? That is what will give us lessons for our lives today. Because the situation, the actual situation is different, but the principles are the same. How the conflict happened, what was it a conflict between, is different. But do we have conflict situations today? Of course. Of course. So how would you deal with that conflict? Right? That is very, very important for us to understand, that we need to relate theology and Islamic sciences to our modern life. Only then will they make sense, and only then will people be encouraged to see value in them and then to practice. Final two slides. The purpose of teaching is to change lives. Not simply to accumulate discrete bits of information and regurgitate them on demand. It is to change life, because only when we understand this, then we can apply knowledge in productive ways, in positive ways. And that's why we need to teach information. We need to connect it by integrating it, and we need to teach the tools: critical analysis, critical thinking, ideating, scenario planning. All of these are tools of how to deal with knowledge. They have to be learned. They're not difficult, but somebody has to be there who wants to learn it. Finally, the question, my brothers and sisters, is, which I ask myself, is if Islam cannot change my life in this world, how can it help me in the Akhirah? If I say I'm a Muslim and my Islam doesn't even help me in this life, then how is this Islam going to help me in the Akhirah? So is the issue Islam, or is the issue the fact that I'm not following Islam? If I'm sitting in a car, I'm sitting in the, you know, latest BMW, absolutely fantastic car, I'm just sitting there, I'm saying this car is taking me nowhere. Car doesn't take you anywhere. You have to drive the car. You have to drive the car. So is it the fault of the car? If you're still in the same place, is it the fault of the car, or is it the fault that you are not driving the car? That is our issue with Islam. Issue is not Islam. Islam has the potential to make us the most beloved people on the face of the planet. Are we there? Islam has the potential to make us the most influential people on the face of the planet. Are we there? Why are we not there? Because like that. The car is there. We are sitting there. We do nothing. We don't drive the car. We have to drive our car, which is Islam, which means we have to practice Islam. Not bits and pieces, fully. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu udkhulu fis-silmi kaffatan. Allah said, oh, you believe, enter into Islam completely and fully. Every aspect of life must be according to Islam. Wala tattabi'u khutuwati shaitan. Do not follow the footsteps of shaitan. Innahu lakum aduwwun mubin. He is your worst and most clear enemy. Only then will we be able to fulfill our purpose. And once we fulfill our purpose, inshallah, Mustafa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed us this in our own history. Allah will give you leadership. Allah gives leadership to those who are not toxic. Allah gives leaderships to those who are positive and who can do good. You might name people and you might say, well, what about so and so? He is a toxic leader. Yes, Allah sometimes sends toxic leaders to punish the others. He's not giving them leadership. Hitler was a very toxic leader. What happened to him? He ruled for some time. And after that, every sign of him was wiped off from the face of the earth. Genghis Khan was a very toxic leader. He ruled for a time. He ruled a huge empire. But after that, every sign of his is gone. So don't get intimidated by now Donald Trump is elected. So what? History will show us whether Donald Trump, I mean, he's just been elected, poor guy, leave him alone for a while. So whether he's going to be toxic or not toxic and so on, history will tell us. The point is not Trump, the point is not anybody, the point is me and you. What is it that I can do? What is it that you can do? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us to take from Him and give to the rest of the world. That's why we came. We came to give, we did not come to take. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Jalla Jalaluhu to be pleased with you, to make this lecture a source of benefit. All of this is open source information. Most welcome. Take it to your schools, use it, enjoy yourselves, and inshallah create some sense of goodness which will come back and help all of us, inshallah. Azhar and so on will send you this lecture itself, plus the video will come, plus all the suggested readings and so on and so forth. Most welcome. Please take advantage of that. وصلى الله على نبي الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين برحمتك يا رب العالمين.